Blackstone Audio presents The Golden Goose by Ellery Queen. This book is read by Mark Peckham. Chapter 1. Princess O'Shea was not really a princess. Her father's name happened to be Royal, and Princess seemed logical. It was also a good joke. Royal O'Shea had had a taste for jokes. It ran in the family. Prin's mother died in attempting to continue the dynasty, and her father lived another 18 years before surrendering to an unregal cirrhosis of the liver. That was when Prin came to live with her father's brother Slater, in his house at the edge of Cibola City, which was not much of a city by any but the most technical definition, although it was a good deal of a house. Uncle Slater O'Shea had money. He had it by way of his late wife, who had acquired it from her late first husband. She had been a realistic lady of some shrewdness. Suspecting rightly that Slater O'Shea had pressed his suit more out of regard for his own future happiness than for hers. But he was also charming and amusing and sometimes exciting, which was all the good lady asked after 15 years of being married to a man whose idea of a high old time was to go to his safe deposit box and see if his bonds and stock certificates were still there. She cheerfully willed Uncle Slater what was left of what she had had when he started helping her spend it. Uncle Slater being what he was, it was not nearly so much as it might have been, but it did include the big old house at the edge of Cibola City and enough income from the remains of the safe deposit box to enable him to live in non-working comfort. A life of non-working comfort had been Uncle Slater's prospector-like dream since he had first struck it poor, which was practically at birth. Prin liked Uncle Slater fine. With his libido now damped by the dews of time, he roared more quietly. And since he had not worked for his late wife's earlier husband's money, he was quite generous with it. He was certainly more fun than Aunt Lally, Uncle Slater's sister, and than Cousin Twig and Cousin Pete, the spawn of another brother, not Prin's father Royal, who had deserted his two motherless chicks and gone off and died, interestingly, somewhere. As for Brady O'Shea, Prin's brother, Uncle Slater was a king by comparison, and Princess O'Shea would have been the first to say so. In fact, she was the first to say so. Aunt Lally and cousins Twig and Pete had been living with Uncle Slater when Prin arrived. Prin was the only one who had come by invitation. The others had dropped in for visits and just stayed on, like the man who came to dinner. And Brother Brady, learning of his sister's providential haven, got there virtually on her heels. Aunt Lally, cousins Twig and Pete, and Brother Brady had not been asked to stay, as Prin had. But, on the other hand, they had not been asked to leave. So it all came to the same thing. The reason that they had not been asked to leave was that Uncle Slater had a tender feeling for scoundrels and a sense of responsibility toward all O'Sheas in the bloodline. In every instance he could think of, Prin excepted. Scoundrel and O'Shea were synonyms, so that at the same time he felt tenderly toward them, he refrained from turning his back, since he took it for granted that any of the quartet was quite capable of sinking a knife in it, especially if the exertion promised a profit. The price of eternal vigilance being exhaustion, Uncle Slater restored tranquility to his aging soul by writing a most engaging will. In this will, he prorated his worth among the 5 O'Sheas who lived with him and 17 other O'Sheas who lived elsewhere. "Those of you who did not flunk simple arithmetic will therefore see," said Uncle Slater to the 5 O'Sheas in residence as he waved the will heartily like a flag, "that my deceased will automatically and ipso facto divide my estate into 22 equal parts. The advantages to all must be evident. So long as I remain in a state of animation, there is enough to support the 6 of us under this roof in freedom from reasonable want. Were I to pass on, however, the butchered bits of my estate would scarcely suffice to support any one of you for more than a year or so. I see that you grasp the unpleasant consequences of my demise. Each of you would be reduced to the alternatives of..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.